you live in Oroville or in the city of Marysville? Nobody here? Sure, you do? In where?
Paradise.
Well, that's not going to be in the floodplain, is it? You're going to be up a little.
We're right above it. We can all be evacuated.
Oh, I'll bet, yeah. I bet like community centers and churches and everything in Paradise. Wow. I have a, my stepbrother lives in Yuba City, and his daughter actually lives in Oroville, so that we get some. And my wife's aunt lives in Marysville, and she evacuated from Marysville, too. So don't know what's going to happen with that, but wow. Let's pray. We'll talk a minute about some one aspect of that, because it brought some philosophical stuff to mind. Let's pray. Father in heaven, what a privilege it is to function in a way that we can feel a sense of communication with the author of reality. We pray that that will never go unnoticed, and that it will not go unexamined either. In Jesus' name, amen. My wife was asking me when we were in line at the grocery store last night. She hadn't been reading the articles and looking at the updates on YouTube and that sort of thing for the Oroville Dam situation. I don't think she's ever been to Oroville. A couple years in a row, the pyrotechnics team that I operated with up till about 10 years ago when our leader died, not doing fireworks, but died of a heart condition, we had the Oroville barge show. We did we shot off all the fireworks from Lake Oroville on the barge for a couple of years. And so we had the Department of Water Resources took us on tours each time we come there, because we'd have new people on the team, and they'd give us take us all through the interstitial parts of the Oroville Dam, which is really fascinating, the tallest dam in the United States. Not the most water in the reservoir, but as far as the face of the dam, there's no equal in the whole country. When I was there, we did look at the whole thing. It's been a lot of years since I was there, but it all looked very sound. I'm told that in 2005, somebody pointed out to me, and then I looked it up, and it's showing up in the news, that there was some environmental group that submitted some sort of a report that urged the state water resources people and maybe the Army Corps of Engineers to reconsider having no cement over the top of the earthen emergency spillway. It had never been used since the dam was built, and never had to use it. And they were looking at it thinking, you know, if you did send water over the top in a deluge situation, it would probably dig itself out, and it would also send boulders and vegetative material downstream so that it would hurt bridges and culverts and maybe even electrical power generation facilities. So the state looked at that and said, pish posh, that's nonsense. And they didn't pay any attention to that. Now, when we state just those facts, and my wife had somebody gossip about that particular item, I guess, when she'd been at work. And so she said, hey, I heard this thing. And I said, well, you know, what does that make you think? Well, it seems like, you know, somebody's going to need to be fired. Somebody's in trouble because, I mean, here's, you know, 180,000 people that have been evacuated. There's no conceivable way that there's not looting and vandalism going on where the people have left their homes. There's no, that's inconceivable that there's not people harvesting people's computers and stereos and everything. Because a lot of people couldn't even get back in to secure their stuff, and in some cases even lock the place up. A lot of people in small towns don't even lock their houses. So it's easy to just glean right out of that and fill your van and take off. And people always do that, at least in this country they do. They didn't in Japan when they had difficulties in Japan with the tsunami, earthquake, reactor meltdown. And there's some interesting, possibly, probably philosophical reasons why in Japan people were absolutely good citizens in managing themselves. When people's stuff was floating, I mean, people were bringing cash that would just float by. Police departments in Japan had to put trailer trucks and temporary steel buildings behind their police stations to put all the stuff, because people brought everything that they found. They weren't willing to profit from it at all. And there's just no way that isn't a philosophical. Because here, when we just had the Napa earthquake, the one that centered close to Napa just a few years back here, the people were running into the stores that had the glass broken out in native people's homes and just looting, having a free-for-all. They had to bring sheriff's departments and police stations from several counties to be out there trying to stop the looting. Related to the Japanese having more of a collective culture and the United States having more of an individualistic kind of a culture. I think that's actually part of it, yeah. When you think about what that means, to have your expectation be that your priority is a bigger group than just yourself. Your own house with, but not even that sometimes. What's happening there, I think, is the Japanese have a huge in-group, and I think that Americans have a very small in-group and a very large out-group. There's maybe some reasons for that. Maybe some of them are cognitive dissonance and the way that we've resolved it historically. I heard somebody tell about some research. They haven't published yet. They're still working on it, but I've had somebody talk in a mini course that I went to at the intensive thing I was at a few weeks back. They were looking at alcohol abuse patterns in the deep south of the United States and comparing them to the rest of the country. And apparently there's this would distribute the alcoholism geographically, it would peak in the south. And the theory that this person has of searching literature and records and trying to do like correlations, he's tying it in his hypothesis to needing to medicate this widespread and acute guilt from abusing people during slavery. And once those patterns get started, you've got other social factors that are analogous to slavery still in the South. When I speak with white people from the South, it's not uncommon at all that white people, much younger than me, certainly old white people, it's not uncommon at all for them to still speak in overtly racist, bigoted, honest. Even Adventists, you know, Christians of every stripe, don't seem to be even slightly an exception to that. They're still saying unbelievably heinous things to indicate that they believe that it's like God's plan that people are stratified. There's some of the people screaming the loudest today in terms of wanting to keep immigrants from coming in when they're in their refugee issues as well. But this notion, backpedaling all the way back to this spillway issue that's eroding, when they, in case you don't know, they were forced to use the emergency spillway, which is basically just letting water run off and go down a dirt hill. You know, there's not any concrete there. It's just like, well, we'll just kind of let it run over there, and we'll call that the spillway, because it's kind of adjacent. It's oriented the same direction, downhill direction, as the regular spillway, and predictably, when you have that much hydrostatic force pounding a hillside, it's just like dredging the thing out. I mean, you may as well be using a big giant drill. It's just pounding the thing like crazy and eroding itself and back cutting and everything, making berms that are then falling. And so within a few hours, they were saying, wow, everybody out. You know, we think it might catastrophically fail and inundate, deluge all the homes downstream, you know, kill people and whole bit. So the question has come up since in 2005, somebody put the state on notice that this seemed like something that would happen. So if those were the only facts, if that's a whole story and that's enough perspective, then you'll look at it and say, who was it that ignored that? You know, you want to say, then we want to, somebody ought to be accountable. And it seems really a natural thing to say somebody needs a foot, you know, right in there. They go to prison or they need to get sued or get fired or whatever. Who's getting fired? That's the big question. What are some possibilities that if we had more information about it might add a balancing statement that would make us say, well, not so fast. Let's not be firing everybody right now. What are some balancing that? What are some other questions we might ask to get some information that we might not have before we start firing people and wanting to sacrifice somebody so that the public feels like they've got their pound of flesh and then we punished like we need to?
First question is, was there a counter investigation to the threat assessment,
okay,
right? So you take them to your manager and you say, hey, listen, we've got a big problem.
Right.
He needs to evaluate, okay, is it a problem? And then
right,
I get a different opinion about.
So if he asks for somebody to come in and investigate it and then, like, say the Army Corps of Engineers comes in or some French firm comes in that's got more geological knowledge than anyone in the U.S. or whatever, and they pay $1 million and they look at it and they say, no, that's really, you probably shouldn't do anything about that, then we would take the monkey off of those people's back. That's one good question.
Makes sense, yeah.
In this case, they did conduct a couple of year investigation and then they concluded that it was unfounded. Yes, sir.
They don't have enough money to deal with the issue. If it's not in the books, there's nothing you can really do about it.
There we go. If somebody says, yeah, somebody says that's an issue, and the voters say, you're not taxing us to pay for fixing the thing. Because where's the money going to come from to fix it, right? What if the amount to fix it is, you know, half of the state's budget for 2 years? I mean, of course, that's not going to happen. It means we'll like have a 11-cent sales tax or something for a little while. I don't know. So that's another good thing, like, so, okay, we knew about it. What the heck would you like us to do about it? Do the people think it's a big urgent thing during a drought? Probably not.
I think it might be interesting, just for peace of mind, of like figuring out the probability of what happening.
Okay.
Before it happened. Like,
excellent.
Like if we could say like, oh, like when they were notified for this, there was like only like a 0.05% chance it's ever happening.
Yeah.
Like it didn't seem like it was very important at the time. Even though, like, obviously it happened. Like.
You're touching on something very important in futurology, in futures studies, in long-term inductive reasoning. Inductive reasoning being, like, hey, the sun has come up every morning since I've been alive, and as far as I know, every morning in, you know, in recorded history. We don't have any cases of a sun dog coming up in the east. So I predict it's going to come up tomorrow in the east. We have a mechanism to go with it, too. And so we calculate the probabilities. Now, the probability of the sun coming up tomorrow is not 100%. That's not accurate. It's not 100%. Because stars sometimes, without warning, blow up or shrink down. And then there will be a day. If things continue as they are, there will be a day when the sun doesn't come up and the earth suffers a heat death. You know, it's not coming up the next morning after that happens. There will be a day. And we actually don't know. But I'd say, using probability theory, it's just extremely, extremely in favor. The odds are extremely in favor of the sun coming up tomorrow morning. If you want to take something that's more ridiculous, but far more possible, but it, I mean, it sounds ridiculous. Let's just say you go to assembly on Thursday morning, and is assembly this week or next week? Is there one this week? There is this week. Okay, so you go there, and Dr. Anderson gets up and says, things are changing, and starting with spring quarter, we're going to have co-ed dormitories. Now, don't you consider that to be improbable? There's a very low probability. But in all likelihood, if PUC stays on the trajectory that it's on in terms of accommodating cultural adjustments and everything, there will come a time where it will that will be the announcement. There will be a day. All the other things that have happened to schools that secularize, PUC is walking the road like on the calendar, just like everything, every other school that has that you're surprised to find is actually a religious school, like USC. USC was like PUC. I mean, very many colleges were, like Harvard was a seminary. It started as a seminary. So to make sure that they could, you know, have decently trained clergy for, you know, in the United States. So there, it is fairly predictable that there will come a time. But we would say that we think that hearing that on Thursday is so improbable that we might even say, I'd give that about, you know, 98-2, you know, against hearing that. You know, maybe 49-1 odds, 48-1 odds. But it's more likely than the sun not coming up, because lots of colleges have gone exactly that route. And if you had gone to them at the point in their cultural development that PUC is, if you'd gone to their constituents and said, what are the odds this will happen Thursday, they'd say, get out. Yes. Yes, that's when the report was made.
Good point.
Have they been saying to people, buy or rent at your own, you know, here's the floodplains, use your head. I mean, if people live in Seattle right now, what have geologists, seismologists, and volcanologists told the people of Seattle? What does anybody know what Seattle has been? I mean, people have said directly, if you live in Seattle, you can count on what?
Is it Mount St. Helens blowing up?
Not Mount St. Helens. What's the other mountain right there in Seattle?
Another mountain.
Huh? Come on, anyone from the North Pacific?
Mount Rainier.
You got it, man. It's a given. It's going to blow up. And when it does, they are doing exactly what you just said. They're letting people know. There's nothing they can do about it. There's nothing they can do. It's not that they can't afford it. They can't pick up the city and move it over to Idaho or something. It's, if you want to live there, you live in someplace where, okay, and in the Bay Area, have people said that, say, in the next couple of decades, there's like more than a 75% chance that there's going to be an earthquake, probably larger than the Great San Francisco earthquake in the early 20th century. I mean, you said it straight up. There's nothing we can do about it at this point. Maybe there will be someday, but there isn't yet. So that's a great point. What are some other things that we might want to know? Yes, sir?
I think it might be interesting also if they have, like the insurance companies have been raising the prices for flood insurance. Like if they knew, like if they knew that it was happening, but they weren't notifying like the piggyback off Taylor's thing, because like where I live, it's a tsunami like warning zone. So like obviously tsunami insurance, is, like what like flood insurance is really expensive.
Right.
Just because they say like here's the line, you're past the line. I wonder if they like had anything like that, because that kind of make you want to.
Does it look like there's some
like
people who are acting on it and others who aren't?
Yeah.
Good question. What else? What are some other things that we might want to ask? Yes, sir.
When these things happen, is there a plan of what the city's going to do to help the citizens?
Okay. Have they said perhaps we can't afford to do what needs to be done to the dam, but we have a plan in place for when and if this thing happens? Because it's been stupid thing has been sitting there for 50 years and it's never had to go over the bank. This is a good long time to feel like it's not exactly a problem event. It's kind of like the sun coming up or not, you know, 50 years. I'm too young to remember when they opened the dam. I do remember, though, I remember when I was young and there was an earthquake that was felt strongly in Sacramento. And it centered right there by the dam. Right there. It didn't do anything to the dam. And so people worried about it, and they talked about evacuating people since it's centered right there by the dam. They even discussed, I remember hearing discussions on the talk shows, on the news, of whether or not the water in the dam had been responsible for causing the plates to move in a more energetic manner. Manner than they'd ever recorded before. I mean, we know now that it's Oklahoma where they're having earthquakes because of fracking and putting the wastewater back in to save themselves the money of having to move the water out. They're just injecting it in the ground in some cases. And in other cases, they're saying, well, it's the process itself of injecting this high pressure steam so deep and so far that you're lubricating the plates, or you're displacing matter and causing all kinds of shifting that just plain would never have happened. So I'm not even sure there was an active fault line before. So don't know. What else might we want to, is there anything else you can find out just because someone gave a report on this thing? Here's a thought. Who was it that gave the report? What was driving those people to give the report? Were they really expressing their real concern? Remember I said what kind of a group it was that gave them the report?
Environmentalists.
Did you say that? What is the deal with environmentalists and dams right now?
They hate dams.
All of them. Damn the dams. And they have succeeded in getting some dams deconditioned and blown up. Drained and taken out, because the dams do in fact mess with millennia old wildlife processes, and there's all kinds of difficulties and dangers with dams. So there's extreme environmentalists who see civilization as a matter of people versus the earth, and they're voting for the earth. And they would like people to leave no footprint at all. That they see it as a big mass to the death, and they're voting for the planet instead of the people. That's their model. Now, they're trying to get dams all decommissioned. So they might not be sincere in submitting their report. Here's a question also. It has been stated that in 2005 they turned in this report about that issue. What if they turned in 10,000 reports the same year about every aspect of the dam? Every aspect. And then you just, okay, now we've put you on notice. People are going, crap, we've got to do our due diligence over 10,000 things. It's going to cost us millions of dollars just to look at each one of these things. They could be talking about every, you know, square meter of the dam surface. They could come up with another issue and brainstorm for years and then submit them all at once and bury some administration. Then anything that ever goes wrong at any dam in the whole country, systematically, you've made it so that you just go and look it up and go, see, I told you so. Predict dramatic failure of everything. And then when it goes wrong, you pull it out and say, see, I'm a prophet. I told you. Now your head needs to roll. You know, will things go wrong? If you have, I don't know how many dams we have in this country, but I'm going to say we have several thousand at least. Do you know how many?
Oh, no. I was going to say, isn't that just kind of like the idea, though, that like Murphy's Law, like something's going to always go wrong or like.
Yeah, things will, won't they? Something will. Because there's just, I mean, even the definition of going wrong will, if nothing really heinous happens, then it becomes a sliding scale and our concern level then embraces things that are just, would otherwise be considered relatively inconvenient. So whatever is the thing we prefer the least becomes the tragedy, right? I mean, think about it. The things that bother us now compared to people that really have something to bother them. Oh, 75,000 dams. So out of 75,000 dams, do you suppose something might go wrong once in a while? I mean, let's just say we were talking about 75,000 cars. You think cars are as complicated and unpredictable as a dam? I think a car is relatively simple. If you ask me to build a car, I'd get a lot further than building Hoover Dam. I mean, let's take, did you say 75,000? Let's take 75,000 young people in good health. How many weeks are going to go by before one of them dies? 75,000. You never have a week go by where somebody doesn't die out of 75,000. Would you? How would you get a sample? So, and then you'd be willing to bet everything that not one of them will have a problem, say, this year. It's ridiculous. Of course there will be a problem. So, you have to be a little bit skeptical or else you're really easily moved into sort of crowd rage. That's the game. That's how people play activism and politics and the whole business. Good point.
I guess they were not following what's
okay. Right. If they are like in the bottom 5% of
like
looking into and maintaining.
And like doing their own evaluations, not just having some other.
Right. Place. Good point. Are they following, say, industry standards? It's like if you have an accident with the car, and they say, well, what were you doing so that you had that accident? Well, I actually was going down the freeway. It was a straight stretch of I-5, so I actually went into the back seat and was digging around trying to get my hand that had rolled back there. But she didn't pull over. Well, no. Well, that's a really bizarre and uncommon thing to do, and shows that you're not doing due diligence. However, to be really frank, if that was a practice that pretty much everybody did, it wouldn't be so shocking, but it's shocking. It's like the people who And I am told that this actually did happen. I don't have any personal knowledge of it, but at least the urban legend is that it actually did happen. It's not actually just a stand-up joke. That when cruise control came out and somebody had cruise control on their RV, they put it on cruise control, and then they went back to make a sandwich. And then they had an accident, predictably, because they were confused. They thought it was also steering and not just not just the accelerator. They thought they had the Google car. You know? It was decades ago, but frankly, I remember not knowing what cruise control was. And the notion that it would robotically maintain your speed, even if you go up a hill, it knows to accelerate, is already la-la land. That's already la-la land. And now, we had a Tesla driver who was killed that was using Tesla's like driver assist mode and checked out doing something else and wasn't driving the car, wasn't paying attention. But it was on a freeway functioning in the pretty much the self-driving mode, but they had told people, don't stop paying attention. You might need to take over for the car. So that seems to us less asinine than putting it on cruise control and going back to go in the little mini fridge and get a sandwich. But it didn't, I mean, our minds were just as blown by cruise control when I was a little dude as people's minds are blown now by self-driving cars.
No, yeah, I heard about that. There was also a woman who was driving and she heard a baby crying, so she went to the very empathetic and cruise control.
There you go.
Yeah.
Very good for the baby. And, you know, I've talked to people who I at first think they must be kidding and I keep waiting for the punchline and they're saying things to me that actually show less intelligence than either of those examples would show. I mean, have you never talked to somebody that is telling you things and you're going, holy cow, I actually think that they're making sense. Have you never had that experience where you're going, you keep waiting and there's no punchline? And it's like, oh yeah, and they're not laughing. They completely are committed to whatever crap is coming out of their mouth. You know, it happens. But how do we avoid being foolish and vulnerable to being swayed like sheep or like little water molecules in as the waves wash over us?
So you educate yourself like on both sides of whatever the argument is or whatever.
Educate yourself on both sides of what the argument is. Excellent. How about saying, what if it was my job to receive and acknowledge and then follow up on that report from those environmental activists? What if it was my job? That's how I was feeding my family. That's what I was doing with my degree. And here you are, and you actually put yourself in, and you kind of, in your imagination, pretend you're that person and say, I wonder what kind of things might have been the deal. Well, now, if there were literally 10,000 predictions that they made of things going wrong, well, what are you going to do? I mean, what they're asking for you to do is get rid of the dam, and you don't have the power to get rid of the dam. Plus, the same people probably charged up their phone using hydroelectric power from the dam so that they could come and take pictures and come back and talk about it. You know, it's like people who are bitching about progress on the internet. Come on. You know, at some point, you got to check and see which side of you you're sawing the limb. People cannot want to go back to Flintstone time so that they can be left in peace on the internet with their power book. Their MacBook Pro or whatever. You can't be Thoreau by Walden Pond and also have broadband. He had no broadband. Anything else come to mind with really having to think about it before you get all charged up when these things come up in the news and you start wanting to? How about the notion of accountability? I'm going to make a shocking statement, and I'm not just saying it to play devil's advocate. I mean it. Justice, the whole notion of justice, is primitive. It's primitive. It doesn't work, for instance, to execute people. But by work, I mean if you have a legal structure in place where you kill people that do certain things, like murder and torture and all that stuff, does it make less murders and torturing and rapes and robberies and capital murder crimes? Does it reduce any of those crimes in terms of the occurrence? Does it prevent those crimes?
How would you handle it if you were
to do what? I wouldn't kill them. If they were dangerous, I would continue to keep them away from other people, keep them incarcerated. It's very, very, very much cheaper to incarcerate somebody than to execute them. Very, very much cheaper.
So for another 30 years, it's cheaper to pay for someone's food and electrical bill and medical expenses and that acquire.
It is.
Than to, say, have a firing squad of five guys with three bullets.
Yes.
Put them down.
Yes. It's very much cheaper. Because before we can put them down, we have to use the very best intellectual technology that we can bring to bear to make sure that we're doing everything we can to not make a mistake and kill somebody that didn't do it. Or somebody who is feeble-minded and shouldn't have been even given the freedom to do it in the first place. Somebody who doesn't have any moral capacity, for instance. It turns out that when you take people smart enough and you try to use whatever model you can, using vast intellectual resources, and you extrapolate that process long enough, it ends up just being millions of dollars for each one of those. Millions of dollars to host an adequate discussion so that we're being as fair as we humanly can. Now you could just say, well, that's just too, you know, it would be, you know, better one man die for the, you know, but it's always somebody's people. It's always an actual human when it comes right down to it. We have to absolutely do our best. And attorneys cost a lot of money. Well, why did they cost a lot of money? Because they could be doing something else. They're not stupid. Try to pass the LSAT. I mean, to be somebody who would be arguing a capital case, they're not going to bring their second string squad. You're going to get the best you can to try to talk about it, right? And then you're going to appeal it at a higher level. The courts, and every time the courts in session, you look around at the people that are just getting salaries for the day and see what that day costs, and it takes months to get to the point where you're ready to say there's no more appeal. Yes.
Yeah, I was
going to
ask, like, if our justice system is so primitive, what would it take to restructure it?
Well, you couldn't restructure it without restructuring us. Because we have what we demand. We will not let go of the notion that if somebody kills our person, we're not going to feel good again until we see justice done. It isn't true, but we really believe it is. It's just like we really believe that if we won $100 million in the lottery, that we would be very much happier, you know, a year later. And it isn't true. But it seems true for me. You know, I would be willing to be a test subject so we could check and see if it's true. Let's see, I mean, you know, just as an intellectual exercise, just for honesty. Someone's got to do it. I'll man up and handle it. You go ahead. I know it'll make me unhappy, but I'm willing to try. But we all kind of are.
So then what are we supposed to do with, like, the justice system? I mean, like, there's obviously...
Oh, well, we can just stop... killing people. For starters, we could just stop killing people. And we could also systematically root out the inequities that make it so that it's so lopsided, depending on what your demographic is and what kind of consequences you're going to face for exactly the same offense. Plus, we can stop making offenses of things that aren't really going to hurt anybody. You know, when the solutions are worse than the problems, then we probably should draw back on the solution. You know, drug laws, for one thing. But we have a lot of reasons why we have those. There's a lot of political expediency. It has to do with what you said, Angela, what you were saying earlier, the in-group, out-group, individual or corporate thing. We are so susceptible to being manipulated when somebody points to somebody and says they're in the out-group, let's get them. It's delicious for us. It makes the right neurotransmitters so that we like it. We like it. I mean, you go on YouTube and you can watch the actual Fleur images from the Cobra pilots firing missiles at pedestrians. You can see that on YouTube. People stay up all night watching that stuff. He did that, but that was about 40 years later. Nixon was in the 70s.
Yeah, but I was saying that they were saying they did research, and so they said they were talking to Nixon and cabinet, and they're like, "Why did you weed isn't bad? Why did you make it so that it's illegal?" And there was like a statement that they did it because they needed an excuse to go after basically the out-group.
That's
like,
right. That's right. I saw that exact one you're talking about. It was well done. Thanks for bringing that up. That's really true. And it might say, well, how can you say that? Well, number one, I was alive. And number two, I was privy to hearing Nixon supporters talk, like right on TV. And they weren't hiding. They weren't even hiding things like that then. You didn't even have to... You didn't even have to hide it. You did stuff, you could just do stuff. Now you have to at least lie about it later. Then it was like you could own that stuff, and it was like, yeah, that'll get you elected. And apparently, it will still. Apparently, that still plays. I don't think it plays as well in California, but it plays in some counties in California. You go way north, and you go in the agricultural parts of California. It's not like the Bay Area. Not at all like the Bay Area. The out-group thing is just delicious. It's just wonderful. You know, you listen to people who are uncritical guns rights people. I'm not against firearms by any stretch. I'm suspicious when the government tries to take firearms away. But I'm really nervous about people that get a really scary look in their eyes when they talk about the day they come in my house. It's like, dude, it will be your best day. And I always ask them, I say, have you ever killed anybody? Have you ever been there when somebody dies? Do you realize what will happen to you if that day that you look forward to as your big day actually comes? Do you know what will happen? And no, they don't. They don't have any concept. But you can feel that they're looking forward to some maggot coming in their house in the night. You know, and they have slogans, you know, to joke about it. talk about just make sure you drag them back into the house after you shoot them, you know, things like that. Because the notion that you don't shoot them in the yard, but if they're in your house, that's different. So they say just make sure that after you shoot them, you drag them back in the house. We got to ask what all is going on in these discussions, in any of these discussions. We've got to get in the habit of, first of all, not entering them without thought, taking a step back and looking suspiciously at everybody who's talking. I mean, there's one thing we could do. Everybody who's talking, whether they're the status quo or they're the activist, whoever they are, whether you agree with them or not, what you said, you could put yourself in their place. You could put yourself in their place. Think about everybody that you disagree with. Them, those others, the people that have heinous ideas, whether it's in Washington, D.C., or whether you're against the tree huggers because you're from a logging family or whatever it is. Whoever, I don't care what your position is on any of it, whether it's racial or religious or political or financial, I don't care. Just think about somebody that's the devil, you know, that's really the problem. And then try to imagine that they're right. What if like the crux of what they're saying is actually true? And here's a shocker. It usually is. It usually is fundamentally probably true at some level. And it might be it's true, and you don't like the fact that it's true, and I don't like the fact that it's true. And that gives you a sick feeling, because it's like, well, how am I supposed to have any convictions about anything? But it is usually quite true what those people that you can't stand are saying. They just did it in the wrong state. If he'd even just met her on vacation in another state, it would have been fine. And then you go, oh, wait a minute, I thought it was an absolute. No, it's just a law in this state. If we go in this state, it's okay if you're 16.
Right. And so, like, where do you find that, like, continuity then? Because, I mean, it's, like...
Do you know that there's registered sex offenders in California on the map with their picture and everything? They're never going to have a life. Ready for this? Both he and she were 17. And they got caught in the car by the cops. Charged both of them with molesting a minor. And charged both of them as adults. Move it to adult court. How about that? They're really on that no way off of it map as perverts. Now, what do you suppose the percentage of people that do those behaviors with people that are they're inappropriate to, by state law to have those behaviors with? What do you suppose the percentage of people who get caught are? How many people looking at the map going, oh, it's perverts, I've been... That if they were honest, they would tell you they'd behave that same way at some point in their life. What percentage? Maybe most. Don't know. Over here, yes, ma'am. I didn't say yours was wrong. Because let's just say that I said that to you. I'm also saying it to them. I'm making a statement to you at the same time. You know, it's so hard to actually come up with something that's exactly opposite. We want to think of things as being binary. Because, for some reason, we have a special neurological mechanism that lives in our frontal cortex, and it's a bias to wanting to settle every matter. My psych students, you've heard this, haven't you? Right? Who's my psych students? You've heard about this. There is a special bias to want to have nothing left ambiguous. We want to have closure bias on everything. We can't stand to say, okay, I'm dealing with this, I can't make a decision, I'm moving along. Okay, I don't know. We have a powerful mechanism that makes that very hard for us to do. Interestingly, this is counterintuitive. I didn't know this. I only recently saw data in this regard. Do you know that at this point, recently at least, people that are over 50 years old at this point actually are less likely to insist that people who disagree with them are wrong? Actually has, at this point, the older you get, the more you're likely to start saying, I can tolerate other people's ideas. They might be right. I don't know. I've been proven wrong so many times. And that, I think that wouldn't have been true when I was a kid. I don't know whether it's a generational thing or whether it's a developmental thing. I don't know what it is. I just heard that within the last couple of days. Did I see a hand over here? What kind of person would you be if every time you really thought somebody was stupid or wrong, really wrong, and you loathed their position, if you actually believe that there is probably quite a bit about the position that's actually true, but you can't, and you were convinced that you couldn't see which parts of it were true. And if you were convinced that for every one of the things that you feel really convicted about, you're really, really sure, you are certain about it. If you said, you know, I'll bet you there's some pieces of my argument that aren't square. If I could really like see from a God's eye perspective, that probably wouldn't be all as neat and correct as I think it is. Well, I don't know which ones. I don't know what those things are, but I'll bet you I don't have any opinions that are flawless. You know? I bet there's just nothing that if somebody just had 30 more IQ points or 40 more IQ points than me, that if I was explaining my position and how right I am, that they would not go, might be right, but it would be a coincidence because it has nothing to do with how you got there. You know? Well, what I'm saying to you is what Socrates considered his point of enlightenment. Socrates had this light that came on where he realized, I don't really know anything. I really don't. I have opinions. I don't really know these things. Even the things I think I know the most about, to be really honest, I don't really know. And it was such a relief it was so lightning, not just enlightening, but lightning, to just say, man, I'm just not sure. I'm just not. In fact, he actually believed that what made him maybe wise was that he knew, and very few people knew for themselves, but he happened to actually honestly believe, realize, and believe that he didn't know diddly squat. The oracle at Delphi, and it turns out that the caves where the Delphic oracles hung out and peddled advice and thought about the universe and gave advice even to rulers and everything, turns out that there was probably a natural mineral process occurring that meant that there was gases in the cave that were somewhat psychedelic. I don't remember what the gas is. I'll give you a curse color. It might have been nitrous oxide, but somebody see if you can figure out online. Just look up the oracle at Delphi and cave and gas. If you Google that, it'll come up and somebody will tell you what gas is. It could have been nitrous, but anyway, there's a theory that those exact caves actually exuded a gas that actually gave them some sort of a psychic portal, similar to shamanic insights obtained by herbal means with psychedelics in many cultures. Yes, sir? Ethylene gas?
Yeah.
Okay, does it say anything about what its neurological effects are? It's an anesthetic? Okay. So perhaps it's something that lowers, if it's an anesthetic, maybe in a mild dose, it might, say, reduce prefrontal cortex activity, which would mean they were able to see ambiguities, and a lot of times you get sort of dialectic insights when you allow for ambiguity. Very good. Very good. That's an interesting point, too, the social expectation, because if people expect you to be wise, you might actually rise to the occasion. If people tell you when you're young that you're a good musician, for instance, because you sang sort of halfway on key once when you were four at Sabbath school, and they say, whoa, you're a gifted musician, then you structure your behavior from that point forward to prove them correct. And perhaps the social expectation for these women that were these oracles were to be, they were used to giving them advice. They were counselors. They did counseling. And when you practice doing counseling, you practice and practice and practice and practice, you're a lot better at it than when you just got out of your social work degree. You've been doing it for 20 years, and you've seen it and heard it all. You have got a little more even-tempered way about you, and you start. Plus, everyone's coming, bringing their questions. They've heard those questions before. You know, what's the meaning of life? You know, the stuff that ends up in, you know, Metallica lyrics and stuff. Good effort.
Really hard.
Yeah, good effort.
Instead of like telling them, like, oh, you're so smart. So it's like that way they attribute it to working hard and like what they were.
It probably would, but we don't. I mean, people with early childhood degrees that have been educated in the last 5 or 6 years probably do, but I'm not sure how many grandmas can resist saying, you are so smart. How many parents, when they know that it's like, now you just have got such a genetic endowment. Yeah, I mean, I see my son doing some cool things, but you know, some part, some limbic reproductive part of me says, it's because he's Superman. He's got a 31-year-old cape. You know, he can leap tall business buildings. He's faster than a speeding public health problem. I don't know how to get us to stop doing that.
Yeah.
You're right, though.
It's interesting, too, because, I mean, like, it goes the other way, too, when you, or, like, how a name can really determine, like,
yeah,
what a person turns into.
Right.
Like,
so what if you were called the Oracle? You might really focus on, and at some point, some of them might actually be, like, they're real people. They might actually feel some ethical constraint to say, I'm going to put my mind to this. And they practice trying to give advice. When Socrates went, talking to the oracle told Socrates that he was the wisest person in all of Greece. And he said, how could that be? I just don't know anything. And then at some point it kind of dawned on him. No, I really don't know anything. I mean, the things I think I know, I don't even know. And then it kind of, the second click was, well, maybe that's why I'm the wisest. Because I don't have any delusions of knowing. At least I'm not saying, oh, and then I'm stupid when the facts come in. Because you're never wrong if you never say anything. I'm going to guess if I would just sort of make it up with what I think about human nature, I would think it would depend on which one and which year or which day you ask. I've spent, like, since I was 21 as a pastor, and now they're telling us in our PhD program that, you know, when you finish all the classes and you're basically just formalizing it with a dissertation, your ABD, they start saying to us, you know, you're ready. And I've compared notes with all of the people I'm in this PhD program with and people in other programs, and every single person feels like an imposter. They can't even bring themselves to say that they're a psychologist or a philosopher or whatever it is their deal is. They can't even bring themselves to say it. Some fields, the second they're given credentials, their chest puffs out and it's like, oh, I'm a blah, 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 blah. And then they think then they're all that. But, man, that has not been true in the psychology program. Can you psychology students see how that would be? I mean, by the time you finish your undergraduate psychology degree, you're going to know how full of crap people really are. Is this true? I mean, and it's abundant. It's ubiquitous, and it's everybody. It's like all the window dressing comes off, and you go, yeah, right. It's easy to become skeptical. Philosophy could be a vehicle to be like Socrates and to become intellectually humble. But it would be really easy to go the other direction with it because it's the undergirding and overriding discipline for all disciplines. And a person who's a philosopher who can actually do philosophy has to have more intellect than a physicist or a mathematician or a surgeon or a chemist. The only people that really among the leaders in their field that historically the only people that that tend to clock higher IQs than philosophers would be like epic writers, you know, people that are serious writers, people that can shape, not just reflect, culture with their writing, people that can make alternate realities when they write. That actually, people kind of think they can. Everyone's going to write the great American novel, but man, when people write, it's usually pretty stupid. I mean, you go through the Barnes and Noble, there's a lot of books. There aren't very many really good books. There are just a lot of them. Most of them are just, yeah. And people, I've written a book, you know. Nobody will publish it. I only had to pay $5,000, and here's my 500 copies. You want to buy one? Absolutely. It's a little harder to tell because you've got some really serious writers and some serious scholars that are, like, publishing on Kindle only. And then you got other people that are publishing on Kindle that you look at and you go, and they can't even put two sentences together to make sense. It doesn't make any sense at all. It's terrible. But it's a hard thing. If you do something that could make you arrogant, when people laud you, like you said, who was it that said it? Was it you that said people were maybe always telling the social pressure? People, it was you that said the social pressure. And did you? Who said something about people always telling them that they were? Is that you? I can't remember who said that. But if you, for instance, if you become a neurosurgeon, who's pre-med? So you become a neurosurgeon, and people go, now what do you do? I'm a neurosurgeon. And you can see them physically. You know, that's really something. You know, Ben Carson. He's a pioneer in hemispherectomy, stellar genius pediatric endocrinologist, and pediatric neurosurgeon. Whoa! When you give that kind of credential, people go, wow, that must be good at everything. It's like Einstein. Brilliant physicist. So if he's a brilliant physicist, he must be good at everything. That's why Israel actually asked him to be their first prime minister. They actually asked Einstein to serve as the first prime minister of Israel. He said, huh? What are you talking about? I don't know how to do that. All I know how to do is this, and not even this so much. What are you talking about? Get out. I'm honored, but they figured, you know, he's really smart. So is it if the wisest and probably really the smartest guy in town was also the guy who thought he knew less than anyone? Thought they knew. And that was Socrates' program. For Socrates, that was enlightenment. That was the thing that went boom and the light came on in his head, was realizing, I don't know anything. I'm so ignorant. He even went around and found people that were sort of experts in their field, and they did know stuff he didn't know. There were people who knew a lot of things around town, and he'd go ask them things, and they were demonstrating that they knew. But he said, I don't even know that. So how could he be the wisest person and the philosopher? In fact, to be humble doesn't just mean, since you're amazing and you're willing to wash someone's dirty feet. That's not all there is. It's not the end of humility. I'm willing to do, like, humble tasks. I'm willing to sweep up the floor. I'm willing to clean up vomit with paper towels. You know, I'll work in the summer in the rest home and wipe people's bottoms that can't wipe their own bottoms because I'm not too good for that. I'm a lot smarter than everybody else. I know things when everyone else is stupid. But I'm also this. You know, all white bottoms. You know, I could do things like that. But, of course, I know that everyone else is stupider than me. So, I mean, it's not just washing feet. Humility is something that has a lot of facets. And it has to be an across-the-board thing to really have real humility, to really not be arrogant, is transforming. I mean, you can look at people that you know are less smart than other people. They're not good at anything. They watch the afternoon TV programs and then all the other TV programs. And they don't accomplish anything. Someone else is paying their way. They don't take care of their bodies. They don't take care of their minds. Their teeth are falling out. If you give them something, they mess it up. You talk to them, and it's like, oh, I'm not keeping. We can't go back and forth. It doesn't make any sense. So it comes back, the whole thing. But you know what? Some of them are actually convinced that they've got it going on, and you don't. Because they're not like, they're not people that think that theirs doesn't stink, you know? And they're not like a bunch of rich priss kind of people. And they're not like pseudo-intellectuals like at the university, you know? And people that don't have any common sense because they're always talking in big words. And you're going, no, seriously, you really think that that gives you a sense of intellectual and functional superiority? That's right. So it's not like the way you get to be humble is just to be a loser. That won't do it. I've found losers that'll brag you right out of the room. So that won't do it. It's not where you need to avoid succeeding so that you are careful not to become conceited. People that are conceited don't need any success to be conceited. They don't need any sense at all. They don't need any money. They don't need any looks. They don't need any skills. They don't need anything to be conceited. They can be conceited and be the bottom of the barrel. So please don't misconstrue humility for avoiding being successful. That's stupid. There's no reason to avoid doing your best. That's stupid. But there's people who do that. There's people who, on purpose, and many, many more people who subconsciously they have a fear that they won't be able to be good people or still be, like, remembering where they came from or whatever if they should succeed. So they do things to sabotage themselves so that they don't succeed. Lots of people. Don't do that. You can be stellar first by recognizing that it's not just you and I that don't know diddly squat. It's everybody that doesn't know diddly squat. And Socrates, at some level, he knew that it wasn't just him that didn't know. He knew that human knowledge is like it is. I mean, you think honestly about the things where you've really told people how it is, because you know. Now, let me ask you, do you really know? How much of that was horse manure? Come on. When you're really going on, you just heard someone else say it. You just read it in a book that you could find 10 books to disagree with, a teacher that you could find 20 teachers to disagree with, or you wrote about it. You wrote a paper about it. I've heard people say, oh, I wrote a paper about that. You look at the paper. It's some formulaic thing, you know. Here's your thesis paragraph, here's your three proofs and your conclusion, and it's like for 101 or for composition when you're a junior in high school. I wrote a paper on that. I know about that. And then we deem ourselves, I looked into that. Come on. I mean, the thing you know the most about. What do you really know about it? I don't.
When you say, like, when you know about something, like, you don't really know, so how should we go about finding out to know more about that thing? Because, like, as you said, like, you could be like, oh, I wrote a paper about, like, something, or, like, I researched something, even yourself, like with like higher degrees, and like you may come across something that's
like. I don't know squat. Yeah. I mean, I can. There's not one thing I could tell you that I know, that I couldn't think of 10 people that it's like, you probably should talk to them.
Yeah. So like, how do we find out what we should be learning since we are like trying to learn things here?
Maybe by restructuring the game. Rather than, hey, I got that, it's in my loot bag, I got, okay, now I nailed that down, I'll move along. Just say, I'm exploring. I get more curious all the time. Because when you actually open a door and look in, you go, oh, I thought I'd find it here. And all I found was more doors. There's a whole room to explore. You know, what's in there? Shoot. Now it's not just a door, now it's a hall. Have you ever searched other people's stuff? Like, whether you, it's like probably the first experience of that is when your parents make the mistake of leaving you home. You know, you know your parents' area pretty well. Don't you? I mean, think about the things you found that you ought not to have found. Let's be honest about going through our parents' things. You know? It's like, I didn't even want to know that, but you know what you do, you know, and you did it to yourself, created those images. I've had to search when people really don't want you to know, you know, searching people's cars and houses and searching their jail cells. And you think, I have ruled out something being in that jail cell. You could take everything out and go through it piece by piece. I've had people, when I've been the corporal on the shift, someone says that they tossed a cell because they got some word from some informant that there was dope in the cell or a razor blade or something, or shank. So go toss cell 23. All right. So I come back and they tossed it. And everything's, guys are mad and they're putting their junk away and stuff. So I go, what'd you find? I'd find me. I go, okay. And I go in the cell, and I come out with a razor blade and a rig, you know, and some rock. And I say, oh, here's your stuff. Where'd you find that? Well, you know, were you sure? I was 100, I turned. I mean, I went like the elastic on their boxer pants around it. I went through it. You know, to say that you know everything that's in there, I said, I don't. You know, I found some things, but I guarantee you I missed some things. I know I missed some things. The more you actually exhaust something, the more you realize you can't. Or, here's the worst part, and this part is going to unsettle you worse than that. It unsettles me. It gives me the shivers. If you get actually to where, in one little laser-focused area, where you get to where that's as much as human beings know, and you're making a contribution on the frontier of something, and then you realize that the bottom line, so far the conclusion is, ready? Well, we don't know. We don't know. Which things is that true of? All things. Everything. There's not any discipline where if you go far enough to it, it turns into, ready? Metaphysics. Every science that exists, when you go far enough to the edge and you don't find that anyone has in human history, in any journal, in any book, in any laboratory, no one said anything else. I've read right to the edge. You're left with something that there's no way to know. No exceptions. Every field and every fact. Doesn't even have to be science. Everything gets to like where you go, and that looks like a miracle. Or, and there's no way to know that. It's not delicious, though. It's disappointing, and it leaves you feeling like, was it you that said, week and a half ago, well, no, 2 or 3 weeks ago, and you said, well, then why do anything? Didn't you say that? Well, then why do anything? Right. That is a good question. But here's a scarier one. Before you realized all of that, why were you doing what you were doing? Not for reasons that still make sense to you. So what might you have done? Especially if someone is on the receiving end of it that disagrees with you. Heinous. Yes, sir.
Isn't that kind of what happened with Stephen Hawking? He just wrote all those books, and then like a year or something ago, he just retracted a whole bunch of things that he previously said that were fact because he realized that he didn't know what he was talking about. And
yeah.
Everyone got really, really mad at him because you're like, you made so much money off all these books and everything.
He made an offhanded statement to say, I don't think there are black holes. I doubt that there are black holes. In his book, The Grand Design, since you raised... did I pay you?
No.
What's the matter with me? In his book, The Grand Design, I think you'd particularly appreciate that particular book. I think it's his last book, so his most recent one. Maybe one has come out since, but the last one I've read of his, anyway, The Grand Design. He said that all scientific theories are actually just databases. They're just databases. They're just collections of what we've observed so far. We arrange them a certain way. And that there's no such thing as a model or a scientific theory that isn't going to, at some point, get into tension with later discoveries, more recent discoveries. And then when enough of that, those discoveries, what we do first is we say, that can't be true because it doesn't fit the theory. So, nonsense. And we won't publish them. We tell people that they're crackpots and religionists and fools, and we tell them whatever, you're denying centuries of science and yada, yada, yada. But as soon as enough of that builds up and everyone kind of goes, oh yeah, man, that whole theory that we're operating under does not square with what we're observing. Then that has to go and get swept away, and what we do is we let those facts in, and then we arrange them a certain way, we've got a theory. And he said, that'll never stop. So that means we should never be at a point where we go, okay, this theory, this is how it is. It isn't how it is. It's how we're going to all agree to say it is until we find out enough more to say, yeah, not so much. That's the model-dependent model theory. And he does the best job I've seen of late in describing model-dependent models. In other words, all it is what we found out. If you decide to measure something. How many of you know how to use Microsoft Excel? How many of you don't know what Microsoft Excel is? Okay, it's a spreadsheet package. It allows you to, it has lines like this if you want to see lines. And it gives an address to each cell. And it goes on. When you get to Z, then you go to AA. Not Alcoholics Anonymous, but just AA. And these will just go forever until you run out of memory. So you can put things in these cells, and they have an address. And then you can put formulas in there, and you can say things like, I'm going to put a 3 in here. Okay, that 3 is going to live in there. And then in C, what I want is I want 2 times what's in B1. So that's what's in there, but it tells you that it's a 6 because you put a 3 in there. If you put a 6 in there, that would be a 12. I mean, you can say things like, you can say D2 equals the sum of, let's say, B1 through B3. B1 through B3. And then what it does is it adds all that up. So it gives you 19. And so you can do really complex things with that. What you can do is you can measure stuff and put the values here that you've measured. When you're in the laboratory and you're taking a lot of measurements because you want to be able to plot those measurements and like come up with formulas, you put all your data in here. And then Excel will draw you a graph of whatever your data looks like. It can be, data can be all over the map. But Excel will let you, remember how to do this from algebra class? You give whatever x you want, and then you get a formula, say it's something simple like that. Remember doing this, and then you have to plot it on here? Most of you have done that kind of thing. So I say 0, negative 1, 1, 2, negative 2, and I go 3x plus 1, oh, 0 would be 1. Negative 2, and 4, and 10, and negative 5, and then you plot those things on here. Remember that? Now, if you started with that and you don't have a formula, sometimes they made you figure out the formula toward the end of the chapter, and then they went on before you really had it nailed. But they made their best effort. They did their due diligence. So this here can be like that, and then Excel was paying attention all the way through there, like the junior year of math, and it'll actually give you the formula for the numbers. So that's how it's called a curve fit, because you get the curve, it plots it, and then you say, hey, tell me what the formula would be for that. And it even says, well, would you like that to be like linear, or would you like it to, because if it's just linear, I mean, gee, that's kind of tough, but we'll simplify it. Maybe linear is not a good model for that one. I'm going with we need something exponential, bare minimum. So what Hawking is saying is that all our theories ever are, it's just one particular possible curve fit for the data that we've observed when we take measurements and make observations. That's all. That's all we have is a curve fit. And you know there's more than one way to make a curve fit. I showed you two, right? Linear is ridiculous, so we're going to have a polynomial function at least. But even that, you can see it's not going to be really. It's not even a function. And that's a problem, because when we observe nature, oh man, a lot of stuff comes up that's not even a function. That's when you go, oh, now we're into. Because you see, I drew something that's not even a function. Vertical line test, right? Uh-oh. You math people know what I mean by that. That's a no-no. It's not a function. But a circle's not a function either, is it? The world is full of lots of circles. Okay? Got a little exercise we need to do. Let's exercise. Everybody?
Can we not?
We're going to exercise.
I don't like exercise.
And you know what? I'm going to make a hard, fast announcement. You ready for a hard, fast announcement? Again, we're not having the midterm this week. Mm-hmm. I'm going to postpone it by one more week. Okay? I'm not adding any reading chapters to it, but you need to stay up.